So, hello everybody. My name is Antonio Loquercio, and as Davide said, I'm a freshly graduated PhD student from Davide's lab. I'm very excited today of kick off this workshop, speaking of agile autonomy, and in particular, how can we learn to fly at very high speed? One of the main research questions was been driving my work over the years was basically, what does it take to fly as good or even better than human pilots? Human pilots are amazing. As you can see in this video, they can fly extremely fast in complex environments, and they can do this because of their awareness of the environment and their ability to just predict what's going to happen in the future. However, machines are still very far from this level. If we cluster, in fact, related work on agile flight, existing work on the axis of speed, so how fast they can go, and the prior assumption they make, we'll mainly see that prior work clusters in two main groups. The first one, upright, can go very fast. Maybe even achieve, get closer to human performance. On the other hand, it makes strong assumption about the environment. For example, it requires to use high quality map of the environment to know exactly where the drone is, which limits their application in all problems where this assumption cannot be done, where we have no idea about the environment before actually flying in it. On the other side of the plot, we'll have works that are completely general. They just need onboard sensor observation. They need no assumption whatsoever of prior knowledge about the environment or of the state of the quadrotor. But on the other side, they fly very slow. They don't usually exploit the capability of drones. My goal, of course, as a PhD student, was to develop algorithms that sit down in the bottom right part of this plot, that make no assumption whatsoever, no prior assumption about knowledge of the environment or of the state, but still can fly very fast. If we have a look at the traditional way of building a system that can fly at very high speed, we'll mainly see that the majority of them divide the navigation problem into subtasks. Specifically, perception, that is building map of an environment, planning to find a plan which is collision-free, and control to just track this plan. This approach, this separation approach, has had a lot of successes, many success stories, many commercial drones use it. However, it has some problems. The first, of course, is that these blocks are subsequent, and of course, doing this, this introduces latency. And on the other side, they don't communicate with each other. Control is completely unaware of perception and the other way around, which might cause error to compound over the pipeline. Therefore, what I've proposed was to learn tightly coupled perception and action policy through a neural network, which takes as input straight onboard sensor observation, like, for example, images, inertial measurement, and a form of a task that can be a GPS coordinate to reach or an image to achieve, and directly transform them into navigation commands. So the two approaches have both their advantages and limitations. The traditional approach, as I said before, is kind of sensitive to imperfect perception. Might generate compound errors because the blocks don't communicate with each other, and also might have high latency because this block cannot be run in parallel. Once I always have to wait for the previous one to finish. However, again, we've seen many success stories, a lot of generalization. Basically, this system can be applied anywhere with little tuning, and they're by design transparent and easy to interpret. On the other hand, learning-based methods are, as I'll show you throughout this presentation, are more robust to imperfect perception, and since it's this kind of a single block, they have lower latency. However, we have the problem of sample complexity. How can we collect enough training data to have good navigation policies? And interpretability, how can we decode the uncertainty of these neural networks? Throughout this presentation, I'll show you some methods that I've developed for my PhD to address, in particular, these two problems. But first, let me define the agile flight in a formal way. Well, we can see agile flight is a discrete time continuous valued optimization problem, where we want to optimize a function j, which is the expected value over the distribution of observer state pi, of a time-dependent cost c, which basically depends on the task tau, again, might be the GPS coordinate I want to reach, and the quadrotor and environment state s, which basically define the state of my problem. Just to make an example, if my task is to track a trajectory, this j would be the expected tracking error. It is, however, important to say that while we want neural network to minimize this functional j, the neural network will not observe s, will not have access to the full state of the environment, but just some onboard sensor observation, like again, images, inertial measurement. In fact, we assume that there is no GPS, no prior knowledge of the environment, and therefore the neural network has to minimize this function, dysfunctional in a partially observable way. We propose to solve this problem by using imitation learning. And the reason is that actually we have decades of robotic research that have generated cutting-edge navigation, planning, and control algorithm. Think about RST-STAR, model predictive control. These algorithms work extremely well. However, to optimally function, these methods require access to the ground truth state of the robot and of the environment S. Of course, they can work only with onboard sensor observation, but their performance is then significantly lower. So the main idea is to imitate those cutting edge algorithms, but not from the state S, but from some onboard sensor observation, like for example, images, IMU again, and the task. But this idea has a problem. And the problem is the so-called expert-student distribution shift. In fact, it can be shown that the difference in performance between the expert, so again, this cutting-edge algorithm like model predictive control or RT-STAR, and the student, so the neural network, depend on the expected action different on the states observed by the student. Why is this a problem? Well, because if we just collect data with our expert and then imitate and then like do imitation learning on this data, actually we will minimize another functional, which is this one, which is basically the expected action difference on the state observed by the expert. Intuitively, this is a problem. In fact, what if my expert only takes me in good states? And then if neural network will end up in bad states, never observe the train time, it will not know what to do. Luckily, this problem has a solution. And is actually a 10 years old algorithm called dataset aggregation, or in short, DAGR, where we basically minimize the original functional in an iterative way. The algorithm basically works as follows. We have our neural network that controls the policy, that controls the drone, and so observes state. And the expert that just annotates this visited state, however, not controlling the platform. It can actually be shown that this algorithm is regret-free, so we will converge to the optimal solution, but applying this in the real world is problematic. Problem number one is that actually in the real world, we have no access to the state of the platform S of K required by the expert. This can, I mean, how can we build map of like a large forest? It will take an incredible effort only for a small training scenario. And also you might see that it can be dangerous to run a partially trained policy on a drone, which is kind of required by the algorithm. We might start crashing a lot, so kind of, wasting a lot of money at any time. Therefore, what I've proposed is to use transfer learning, which is to train in a different domain, for example, simulation. Transfer learning is indeed very appealing. In fact, if we train in simulation and then test in the real world, we basically cannot harm any platform at training time. It's very cheap to collect data, and we can train actually on any task, even the ones that are difficult for human pilots and for which actually having a safety pilot could be kind of a problem. But the question is, how can we transfer this knowledge between domain? Well, one of the main idea, which basically was developed throughout my PhD, is to use abstraction. Actually, what it can be shown that the perception, that the performance gap between a policy in simulation and in the real world actually depends between the covariance shift measured in terms of the Wasserstein distance of the perception and action models of the two domains, which basically control how the drone moves and perceives in the two domains. It is actually possible to decrease this covariance shift by using abstraction functions. Let me make you an example to ground this up. Suppose I want to train a drone to fly in a forest, but at training time, I only have simulated images, which are actually very different from real images for many reasons. One of them could be, for example, the lighting or the rendering. But now if I abstract pixel information with, for example, depth information, you see that the two domains start to get closer because depth just measures distance to points and is more or less independent on the rendering. We have applied this idea on several demonstrators. The first one is drone racing. And in here, we just used domain randomization to learn this abstraction function. So the algorithm is the following, very, very simple. We just randomize everything, the gate shape, the background, the illumination, and train our policy on this data. It turns out that a policy trained exclusively on this data can then generalize on a physical platform and achieve high good performance on a real racetrack. Very interestingly, the performance was comparable, if not superior, to the performance of a network that was trained on real data collected on the real platform. But we don't always need to learn abstraction function from scratch. Sometimes we can also use our domain expertise to build abstraction. And that's what we did in deep drone acrobatics, in which we said, okay, for the task of acrobatic flight, like we can abstract images with feature tracks, because that's what I need to estimate my ego motion together with inertial measurement. Using this idea, we were able to train a policy in simulation would then generalize on a physical platform for these like very aggressive maneuvers, as you see here, for example, as a backward loop called Matty Flip, or a forward loop called Power Loop, which actually push the platform close to its physical limit. More recently, we have also kind of extended this idea for the task of agile navigation in the wild, so basically in the forest, in a mountain, where we achieve performance which was even superior to the one of a physical drone, of a commercial drone, as you can see in this video. Also here, we use the same idea, zero shot simulation to reality and abstraction functions, in this case was depth, to favor the transfer. So this idea of abstraction kind of works, and I would like to show you this through quantitative experiments. I'll do this for the task of navigation in previously unknown environment, in particular from the green point in here to the red point on the right, where again, basically the neural network only observes local observation, has no notion whatsoever of the point cloud. It's actually possible to see that our approach showed in green as performance which is kind of way better, in particular at high speed, than traditional methods which work well at low speed, but whose performance actually degrades as the speed increases. So transferable abstraction, we have seen it kind of works well, but it has some limitation. The first is that this abstraction function is domain agnostic, we have seen it, but it's task specific. So we might attempt to learn it with randomization, but actually this requires strong simulation engineering. We need to decide what to randomize and how much. Also, predefining abstraction function is possible, as we've done in drone acrobatics and in the agile flight in the wild, but this is kind of decided by a human and might be possibly non-optimal. Also, despite abstraction, we cannot account for motions that were never observed in the training domain. Suppose, for example, that during training time, I only see planar motion, so only move on a 2D plane. Then there is no abstraction that can tell me, okay, actually you're a drone and you can move up and down. So of course, this tells us that the better simulator we have, the better is going to be the transfer. But what about all effects that are too computationally intensive to model? Like, for example, some particular type of contact forces, some aerodynamics, or even more difficult interactions with other agents, like, for example, humans. So this is kind of, I think, a very exciting venue for future work in this domain. But like close up, I would like to maybe put like a controversial question, and that is, can we always trust neural networks, in particular in robotics? Actually, I think the answer is no. And a safety critical system, like for example, a drone, cannot blindly trust neural network because, well, current observation might be different from the training one, or sensor might fail. So it seems that we need a notion of uncertainty to at least detect such kind of failures. The total uncertainty of neural networks actually depend on two components. The first one is the so-called data uncertainty, and it's basically the propagation of the sensor noise throughout the neural network. The second one instead is the so-called model uncertainty, and basically measures how much a sample is similar to the training ones and can actually be seen as an uncertainty on the network weights. The fact that the total uncertainty is divided in these two components is actually already well known. But what we've seen is that related work actually calculates them independently and then combines them naively, for example, using addition. But what you've seen that as soon as you start working on a more complex task on safety critical system, then this division results in an underestimation of total uncertainty. That's why we've proposed a novel general framework for an uncertainty estimation, which actually takes into account the relationship between these two uncertainty and actually kind of avoids this underestimation. This framework is kind of also, I would say, comes with some good characteristics, which might be kind of good for people not working in the area and that just won't apply it. And the first one is, of course, that we are completely agnostic to the architecture, to the task and the learning process. You could actually train a neural network which is already trained, plug that in, and you would have, together with the neural network prediction, also some notion of uncertainty. At the same time, it can use some prior information that you might have, for example, the noise that is already in your sensors. We have demonstrated this framework on several demonstrators, on both computer vision and robotics task. The first one was future motion prediction, which is kind of, by definition, a very ambiguous task. We want to predict where agents will move in the future in terms of the optical flow. What we've seen is that we obtain performance which is superior to the one of the existing method, and also a kind of intuitive. Like, for example, if we predict how a dancer would move, we would see very low uncertainty on the pivot points. This, like the agent here is rotating, so on his hands, but we would have higher uncertainty on his legs, which are actually free and can move in any direction. Also, to connect to the previous part, we've also seen how works uncertainty together with end-to-end control. In particular, in here we've used a neural network to predict motion drag, air drag, and put this together with uncertainty in the following way. If the uncertainty of the neural network is too large, we then just switch to a safety controller. We have actually seen that this policy improved the performance, actually improved tracking error with respect to neglecting uncertainty completely. So this kind of concludes a bit my presentation, the things I wanted to tell you. And here some few takeaways that I think you will basically remember of what I said today. First of all, I hope I convince you that vision-based agile flight is a very cool research topic. It's very challenging, yet very interesting. And we might have actually another decade to solve it, to arrive at the same performance of human pilots. It's nice to work on it because we push the limit of existing vision-based algorithm, and we do this in extreme situations. And of course, we also raise fundamental problems in robotic research, like perception, planning, control, and learning. Another thing that I hope you will remember is that simulation to reality transfer is possible for this complex task by using input-output abstraction, which can either be learned or designed by using domain knowledge. And eventually, meshing network uncertainty is actually something that we should always take into account when we put neural networks in drones, because this helps us to detect failures and of course, also promotes safety. With this, I'll conclude, and I'll thank you for your attention.